Good morning, everyone. We're about 7 minutes late, so, and that's not what we normally do, so I guess we better get moving here. We know it is October 2nd, even though it says September 25th up there, but we know where we are, and it's okay. I'd like to welcome everybody this morning. If you are new here, welcome, and I hope you come back again. For everybody that's here regularly, welcome, and it's a beautiful day, just a gorgeous day. We have multiple prayer concerns. If you need to get a piece of paper to write them all down, I totally understand. Announcements, and that is Penny Gray's memorial service is next Saturday at 11 o'clock. There will be a luncheon afterwards where we can all come together and share our Penny stories. If you can bring something, would you let Martha, you can turn around and look at Martha because some of you might not know Martha, or Mary Good, you can raise your hand and everybody get an eye on Mary. Either of those two ladies, if you know what you're bringing or you'd like to bring something, let those two girls know. We have a joy. Gary Williams' eldest son, Josh, welcomed his new son, Reese, yesterday. So that's exciting. We want to pray for a young woman, Ronnie Piccolo. She's suffering cancer and she's a young mom. So it's been an ongoing situation there. So keep Ronnie in your mind, in your hearts and prayers. We lost a longtime member this past week, Julia Gaffner. She was quite an active member. In her obit, it mentioned she was a Sunday school teacher, which we're no doubt about. So keep the prayers of the Gaffner family in your hearts and prayers. Kim's sister, Donna, prayer for Donna, and prayers for Marjorie, Kim's daughter. And on Monday, Kim has a bone density test, and she's kind of worse. Pardon me? Next Monday, two Mondays away. We assured he was going to be okay, but we'll keep that in our prayers. Richard China, we want to extend prayers for family health, and his family had a home in Florida, and we're not sure quite what happened to that home. So keep Richard China and his family in your hearts and prayers. And lastly, of course, we want to think about Florida itself, the whole state, North and South Carolina. Mother Nature has reared its ugly head, and it's not going to be the same. So we need to pray for that community, that very large state and community. If there is anything else that we need to keep in our hearts and prayers. If you're able, could you rise and we could do the responsive reading? Holy and loving Lord,
you are our Redeemer
and refuge. You have called us to be holy. As you yield our lives to you, transforming us into Christ's image. Sanctify us, Lord, as we commit ourselves to you, for we are yours forever. Opening hymn is number 384, Love Divine, All Love Excelling. Guide us to know you and love you even more. Our lives transformed, a new creation, by the power of your mercy and love. Amen. A thankful moment. There, how exciting it is about what this church community is doing in the community. I am just so excited about what God is doing in you and through you. My goodness, lives are being touched and people are becoming transformed. So we had that picnic that we had for the community, which Howard spoke to last week. But with that, we were able to meet a bunch of people who then were invited to come and bring their children to what we had on Friday night, a back-to-school batch. And then with Worship Without Walls, I ran into one of those same people that was there at the picnic who just happened to have a child who just then signed their kid up and they were able to come, and they had a great time. We had people on Friday night ministering to a whole bunch of children who ran around and they played games and they did crafts and they learned more and more about God. It's a really good thing, amen? We are doing some awesome things in the name of God, and I am just so excited for what God is sparking within all of us to be able to continue on God's mission to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And so in this time, when we take a moment to give back to God for what God has already done, what God is continuing to do, I thank you for your generosity, because the generosity that you give is enabling this church to continue to do such wonderful things. And so I thank you, and I encourage you, and I want to just say, yay, God! And thank you to everybody. So as we take this time, reflect on God's goodness, reflect on gratitude for all the things that God continues to do in you and through you, and just say some thanksgiving for it all.
Thank you. thank you for your continuous mercy and grace in our lives, for your provision and your love, for opportunities to serve in and through you. Lord, we thank you for all that you're doing in our lives, and we pray that you will take these gifts that we're giving to you in gratitude and with commitment to you. You would bless them to be a blessing to others, that they too may come to know you, to be transformed by you, to be led by you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please be seated. Do any kids want to come up? Any kids want to come up? Huh? Timing is everything.
I'm going to move it right along then.
Our scripture this morning is two verses from chapter 23 of Matthew. Matthew, the tax collector, who was transformed. Verses 25 and 26. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you cleanse the outside of the cup and of the plate, but inside they are full of extortion and rapacity. Rapacity, which means extreme greed. You, blind Pharisee, first cleanse the inside of the cup and of the plate, that the outside may also be cleaned. May God bless to us the meaning of this scripture. So this passage is from a whole series of woes, seven woes total, and this is the sixth one. Jesus is in Jerusalem during Holy Week, and he is calling out the religious rulers for hypocrisy and the harm that it was causing. The word hypocrite originally comes from Greek theater, referring to an actor, one who was two-faced. The false self and the real self, wearing a mask, performing a role of being someone that was not really themselves, the real person hidden behind the mask from everyone else. And the religious rulers were doing just that, wearing masks. Not a literal mask, but putting on a facade, stepping into a character, having an outward appearance of being spiritual and holy and godly, going through the motions of religious practice. And yet, hidden behind the mask was the real person who was far from spiritual and holy and godly, the person they professed themselves to be. Jesus described the outside, what everybody sees, as clean. They had the appearance of being clean, but Jesus knew the inside, who they really were, and he knew that it was not. Jesus named just a couple of the many things that were unhealthy and ungodly behind their masks: greed and self-indulgence. But as we read through the Gospels, we learn much, much more of what's really hiding behind that mask: slander, gossip, envy, jealousy, hatred, rage, and even a longing to kill Jesus from the holy people. They were wearing masks, but Jesus was doing the unmasking. Masks can cover up a whole mess underneath. I remember wanting to go car shopping many, many years ago. You know, when you're searching for your first car, you're not going to get a new one. You're going to go for an old one, right? And my dad insisted on going with me because he was a mechanic. And he knew that I could possibly be swayed by just how pretty the car looked, how clean it was, all the color, the shape. Oh, it's a cool car, right? Anybody else go through this? Yeah. And sometimes all of that mass, a car with a faulty engine, right? It doesn't matter how fresh the paint job, if the engine is bad, it is not going to go. And my dad would, thankfully, insist that we
and after a thorough checkup, give it a test drive. How does it run? Are the gears shifting properly, or does it need a new transmission? Is it stopping easily, or does it need new brakes or even new rotors? Is it quiet, or does it need a new muffler? Check it all, because it doesn't matter how it looks on the outside. If it doesn't start, and if it doesn't run, it won't be able to be used for its purpose. The same is true for us. As much as none of us want to admit to ever wearing a mask, covering up who we really are, too often people do, especially, honestly, in churches. I mean, everyone has a desire to look as if we're okay. We got it all together. We got it all figured out. No problems. All good here. We have a desire to make people believe that we are mentally, emotionally, and spiritually mature. It was the persona the Pharisees sought to portray. And Jesus said, "Woe to you," because he knew the truth. I mean, most of the time when people share why they don't want to go to church, when you ask people who aren't going to church, why do you not want to go? Usually it has nothing to do with God, nothing to do with Jesus. They're actually really quite good with God and Jesus. It's generally about people. People who profess to love and follow Christ. One woman was quoted as saying, "How can someone who says that they know and follow Jesus look so little like him?" The people in the church, all of us, myself included, we try, right? We try. But sometimes trying is only affecting the external. There's a striving, just like the Pharisees, to look the part, prim and proper. And yet, too often, it is experienced by others as unsafe, uncontrolled, and unkind. There's a bumper sticker that people use a lot, that I used to love. It says, "Not perfect, just forgiven." Anybody ever see those? "Not perfect, just forgiven." And that is true, right? It's absolutely true. None of us are perfect. All of us, each and every one of us, has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And if we come to Christ, we are forgiven. Absolutely. It gives a message to anybody who reads it that it doesn't matter what you're struggling with, you are welcome here and we will love on you. You are okay to be here with us, because none of us are perfect, right? It's all true. I struggle with the slogan now, because as good and as true as it is, and it is, it can also send a message that we aren't doing, as John Wesley said, moving on to perfection. No, we aren't perfect yet, but we are heading there, right? I mean, that is the goal, right? Christian perfection, heading in that direction. Sanctification. We were here, we're here. We're growing, right? In Christ, in holiness of heart and life, moving on to perfection. And it said, we can say to people, wherever you are on this road, join us for the journey as we together move on to perfection. We set our sights on that. I mean, that's the process of sanctifying grace. We all start our spiritual journey as immature. Everybody does. Which is connected, though, to our inner lives, our thoughts and emotions, as well as our outer lives, our own behaviors, and our behaviors toward others. The spiritual practices are designed to guide us toward sanctification, becoming more and more like Jesus, more and more toward spiritual maturity with the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self control. We all want more of that, right? We all want more of that, amen? Amen. We all want more of that. That's who God is. We're supposed to be growing more and more like that. And it's within the church that we're supposed to pop open the hood and examine the engine, the inner parts of our lives, along with the Holy Spirit, the master mechanic. We are supposed to work on our engine, get our hands dirty, replace what's broken, fix what can be repaired, fill what's empty. The church is where we come to get an engine overhaul and then get constant checkups and tune-ups. The church is where we practice spiritual disciplines, which guide us and fill us with God and transform us from the inside out. The spiritual practices won't do anything without our cooperation with the Holy Spirit. See, the Pharisees, they were doing all of the spiritual practices. They were just doing it going through the motions. They were strong in religion. They participated in it all. They knew scripture. They prayed. They fasted. They served. They gave. They followed all the rules. And Jesus said to them, "Woe to you." So we could be coming to worship, attending Bible study, maybe even teaching, praying, fasting, giving, serving, and any other spiritual practices that are in our spiritual garage. But if we don't open that hood and look at our spiritual lives, including our emotional and mental health, and allow those practices to make an impact, doing the dirty work of cleaning, fixing, and tuning up our engine through the power of the Holy Spirit, then we will remain spiritual infants, spiritually immature, not healthy, not growing, not transformed, not moving on to perfection. Our spiritual garages could be packed with all the necessary tools that make us run well, but if we don't actually pop the hood open and use those tools on our engine, then it doesn't matter how many tools we have or how beautiful our car is on the outside. It's just a mask hiding the truth. When we're not healed, transformed, sanctified, we have an unhealthy and ungodly approach to circumstances, situations, and relationships. And it's especially evident in times of stress. I mean, most of us can hold it together most of the time. But when stress comes, ooh, it comes out. It comes out, and the mask that guards us starts to slip. And too often, it reveals something ugly, seething or erupting with rage, lashing out from bitterness, collapsing from unhealed wounds that carry forward and lash out at others, gossip and ripping down other people, reactive, bombastic, controlling, venomous instead of victorious in Christ. It can manifest in an anxiety that then leads to an eruption of sudden outbursts and tantrums and defensiveness and hypersensitivity and so much more. But instead of recognizing it and dealing with it, our own pride or arrogance or fear or whatever it is, we'll often react to the reaction with a cycle of shame that is self-destructive. So we erupt, and then we stuff it, and we internalize it, and we carry it until finally, bam, it erupts again. And then we go back to shame, and we feel bad about ourselves and others and God until finally we carry it, and it erupts again. And we go through the shame pattern again, cycles and cycles of thoughts, of emotions, of behaviors that are unresolved and unhealed. You could have been a Christian for 50 years, but instead of being a 50-year-old Christian, you could be a 1-year-old Christian who's done it 50 times. Just keep doing it over, over, over again without growing up spiritually. None of us are without sin. 1 John 1:8 through 9 says, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. We own that. We got work to do, right? But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. The goal is holiness. The bumper sticker says, not perfect, but forgiven. God will forgive us. And I'm thankful for that. Amen? But I'm sorry. Without repentance, without changed behavior, without a willful, intentional attempt to change, is insincere. It's like someone coming up to you and saying, back. Oh, I'm sorry. Back. I'm sorry. Back. I'm sorry. Anybody experience this? Are we going to ignore it all? Not checking under the hood? Because if so, we will likely not get very far before we see billows of black smoke coming out from under the hood. And we break down for some reason. We all need to be digging deep, checking under our hoods. We have to ask ourselves, when's the last time we had a tune-up? Do our spark plugs still spark the Holy Spirit's spark within us? Is there enough oil, anointing oil, that has us moving smoothly in our mission, our passion, our gifting? Is there enough gas fueled with love of Christ to keep us going? Is our battery charged? Have we been filled up with the power of the Spirit? Is there water? Is there antifreeze? So that when the enemy attacks, we can stand strong and keep on going. Do we need to get rid of any rust, any of the stuff that's built up over time, the sins that have just sort of collected there, and we've got to scrape that off and get rid of it? What is the condition of our engine? Popping open the hood means being willing to be vulnerable before God, which is what's needed to heal and grow. Being filled with holiness, becoming more and more like Christ. In humility and vulnerability, we recognize we need Jesus. I know I need Jesus. And with a repentant heart, we confess to Jesus that we cannot do it alone. We accept forgiveness and are filled with the Holy Spirit who will convict us, letting us know if we're heading the wrong direction, if we will listen. It will guide us, leading us in God's way, if we will follow, and giving us the power to go and grow if we will accept it. So we grow through spiritual disciplines when we approach them with that attitude, and especially when we're doing it in faith community. The faithful fellow believers in Jesus Christ who will encourage and strengthen as we also hold one another accountable, speaking the truth in love, and praying for one another. We're going to be starting the faith focus again this week. So if that's something, if you're new here, it's where we take this scripture that we have today and we're going to really examine it. You can take as much time with it or as little time with whatever. It's available to you. And basically goes through and ask questions for you to meditate upon. Ponder. Sit with God for a moment and really be immersed in what God's saying. We're also going to be in a few weeks starting a 3-week series of small groups where we can gather in community and start sharing with one another what's going on under our hood in a safe community, growing together in Christ, because growth is the goal. Amen? Growth is what we're here to do. I want to encourage everybody to take a part, step into that. We don't want to just be doing church, checking off all the boxes. God wants so much more for us. God desires for all of us to have a genuine, transforming faith, growing in love and life, growing in faith and hope, growing in sanctification, more and more like Jesus. And an essential part of becoming more like Jesus is allowing the Holy Spirit to strip away any and all false constructs, all the masks that we wear, so that our true selves in Christ can emerge, who God created us to be. God is calling all of us to a deeper place with Him and within Him. So we can come before Jesus and say, Lord, I need you. I'm here. And dwell in the abiding presence of God. And that's when transformation happens. Lord, I need you. I invite you all to stand if you're able as we sing and worship together. Lord, I need you.
Thank you.
Yes, we're here to
praise God, to worship God, but part of the praise and worship is to recognize that we all need Jesus, right? That worship is not a performance where we put on our mask. Worship is a time when we come before God and say, we need you. I need you. Lord, I need you. It's more of a hospital than a stage performance, isn't it? Where we have ministry with one another, where we pray for one another and with one another. And it's a wonderful opportunity as a body of believers to lift up our prayers in unity before God, sharing our concerns together. Let us pray. Lord, you are the one that we are praising. You are the one that we are seeking. Lord, you are so generous and kind and full of grace. And we come before you today recognizing our need for you as we try to continue to carry burdens from this world. Lord, enable us to place them at your feet, trusting in you. Lord, we pray that you will bring healing to so many areas. Bring healing to people's bodies as they struggle and suffer with pain and disease and brokenness. We pray for bodies to find your healing and to be restored to how you created them to be. We pray for healing in relationships, that people would begin to see one another through your eyes, that they would say together, Lord, we need you, and allow your Holy Spirit to enter into relationships, build our relationships stronger and stronger, enable us to treat one another with your grace. Lord, we need you. We need you in every and all circumstances. We pray that you would come and fill us to overflowing with the power of your love so that we can minister to others in your love. Heal us from brokenness. Heal us from pain. Heal us from our bent to sinning. Lord, we pray for all the people that are struggling and suffering around the world. Lord, we offer them to you for your grace to abound. The people who are struggling with the hurricane, the people who are struggling in the Ukraine, people around the world who are suffering with persecution and oppression, that they would experience your grace, that they would experience your healing, that you would provide opportunities for them to be safe. And Lord, we pray that people who are called by your name will step into brokenness and bring healing with them. Help us all to be those people, to bring healing with us into every circumstance, every relationship. Lord, we pray for all the people who are struggling emotionally and spiritually, who are struggling with anxiety and depression and sorrow and shame and so much more. Lord, we need you. Bring your Holy Spirit and fill us with your healing presence. Reveal to us anything that you would have us change. Reveal to us anything that's broken within us. We know we're not there yet, Lord, but we seek to know you more, to live more and more like you and more for you. And Lord, we know that we've not always done that. And so hear our prayer of confession as the people of God repeat after me. Lord, I have sinned. I've not always followed you. I've not always been loving. Sometimes I've intentionally sinned. Forgive me, Lord. Set me on your path of holiness and righteousness, of love and grace through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Hear the good news. Good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. And this proves God's love for you and for me. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. And so we celebrate God's grace, God's love, with the tangible way of experiencing that with the sacrifice that Christ made for us, remembering that there is resurrection in the end. And God's grace is offered to everyone and anyone. Anyone seeking after Christ is welcome at the table of grace. It could be your first time here, you've been here since you were born, doesn't matter. God welcomes you. And so let us celebrate together. The Lord be with you. Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image, breathed into us the breath of life. And when we turned away and our love failed, you remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through the prophet. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captive and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always, in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you, poured out for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of this often, remembering me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. by your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now with the confidence of being children of God, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Well, those who are serving, please come forward. The table is open and you are welcome to receive. And if you'd like to come up and pray, we are available. Beth and I are going to be up here. And if you want to pray for anything, you just want to have somebody pray over you, we're here. Because we're in this together, right? Amen. Come.
Go with God's presence with you and surrounding you, and go in the world sharing that with others. Amen.
Amen.